On This Week in Enterprise Tech, a country is servicing out its citizenship. We talk about open data and open governance, and we have a great guest, TJ Layer from Cloudera, where we talk about big data and Hadoop. Twyatt on the set.
Netcasts you love.
From people you trust.
This is Twit.
Bandwidth for This Week in Enterprise Tech is provided by CacheFly at cachefly.com.
This is Twyatt, This Week in Enterprise Tech, episode 190, recorded May 20th, 2016. Hadooping it.
This Week in Enterprise Tech is brought to you by Ministry of Supply. Ministry of Supply uses performance technology to make your work clothes incredibly comfortable. For performance menswear designed to work with your body, visit ministryofsupply.com/enterprise and use the code ENTERPRISE to get 15% off your first purchase. And by Thinkst Canary. Detect attackers or malicious insiders on your network with honeypots that can be deployed in minutes. For 10% off and a 60-day money-back guarantee, go to canary.tools/twit and enter the code TWIT in the How Did You Hear About Us box. And by Igloo Software. Igloo is an internet that you will actually like. It connects people with the information they need to do their best work. Try it for free at igloosoftware.com/twit or sign up for a live demo to see it in action.
Welcome to Twyatt, This Week in Enterprise Tech. It's a show dedicated to the enterprise professional, the IT pro, and the geek who just wants to know how the world is connected. I'm your host for today, Louis Maresca, your guide to all things in the world of enterprise. And now that I'm back from my TPS reports and working on the weekends, I can geek out with all of you around some enterprise tech. But I definitely don't want to do this ride alone or co-host alone. I'm joined by some of the top enterprise tech professionals in this world. My friends, my colleagues, starting with Mr. Brian Chee, the Director of Advanced Network Computing and Laboratory in Hawaii. Welcome back, Brian.
Yes, I was in not so sunny New York, actually Tarrytown, New York, right next to Sleepy Hollow. And big congratulations to one of our part-time co-hosts, Oliver Rist, who just tied the knot. And big congrats to Oliver and his new bride.
Congratulations, Oliver. Welcome back, Brian. So also joining us, another amazing guy, Mr. Curtis Flanken from Information Week Radio. Curtis, welcome back.
It is a pleasure to be here as always, Lou, and enjoy being with you and not being in the air-conditioned confines of SAP's Sapphire Now conference, where I spent the week, and we'll have some news about that coming out of that in just a short while.
Fantastic. Well, folks, we have quite a show today. Not only will we talk about a country servicing out their citizenship and how public data potentially is changing or pushing change in policy, but we also have a great guest who's going to take us through the world of big data and talk about Hadoop. But before we go to that, let's go ahead and jump into the blips. Payday loaners have known to not only offer extremely high interest rates, but also been known to be accused for entrapping people in the circle of debt. Just days after Google proudly announced that it banned morally suspect payday loan sectors from advertising platforms, its parent company, Alphabet, revealed to be a repeat investor in a payday loan lender. GV, or venture capital investment arm of Google's parent company, Alphabet, has backed online lender LendUp since before its launch in 2012 and has provided a capital for every equity round LendUp has done since. LendUp charges about up to 400% in APR for loans off future paychecks and operates digitally only. Last week, Google added payday loaners to a list of dangerous products category alongside guns, tobacco, and explosives. LendUp CEO feels it paints with too broad of a brush, but will play it out for now.
SAP HANA goes bigger and better. This week at Sapphire Now, SAP announced the latest release of SAP HANA Platform, SAP HANA SPS 12, a version of the in-memory database that includes new capabilities in transaction capture and playback, new tools to help users analyze and visualize data, and a number of enhancements intended to make HANA a more compelling option for organizations, both large and mid-size. Among the more significant portions of the announcement, capture and replay is a capability set that allows a team to capture complex database transactions, then replay deploy them on a different system for development, testing, and migration purposes. HANA's analytics and visualization capabilities are bound up in what SAP calls graph data processing, a set of functions that provides visual tools to help users understand the relationships that exist between the various data types and sources available to the database. SAP is continuing to expand HANA's capabilities as the company works to remove enterprise objections to this very fast analytics database.
Well, it's our worst nightmare. Misconfigured antivirus scan disrupts a patient's heart operation. In an incident described by the Food and Drug Administration, a patient's heart operation was disrupted because a key piece of equipment got taken over by an antivirus scanning tool during the operation. It was clearly a case where the auto scan function was set for a poorly chosen time frame. But with more and more cyber attacks and intrusions, it's very clear that hospitals are tightening up on cybersecurity, and this was bound to happen someday.
For years, Flash has been under fire for repeated partaking in the world of ad misdirection, malware, performance issues, and security problems. And Google is not going to take it anymore. Google is looking to make HTML5 the default going forward instead of Flash. Chrome will instead show the HTML5 experience instead where available. They will whitelist specific sites who depend on Flash for only a year. Then the whitelist will be flushed. Users will still be able to display Flash content, but they will be presented with a nice yellow warning bar at the time, which is known to deter users from actually moving forward or using features. Meanwhile, if you have the site that requires a Flash, it might be time for you to move to HTML5 because the Chrome browser that holds over 60% of the browser market share is a coming for you.
SAP and Microsoft are bringing HANA to Azure. Microsoft and SAP are deepening their partnership with new integration between Office 365 and SAP's cloud products, as well as a plan to bring HANA to Azure. SAP HANA and S4 HANA apps will be certified to run development, test, and production workloads on the Azure cloud, so users don't have to download the SAP software onto their servers to use it. In addition, the communication and collaboration tools, documents, calendar, and other data in Office 365 will be combined with Concur, Fieldglass, SuccessFactors, and Ariba from SAP. According to SAP and Microsoft executives, the idea behind the expanded partnership is to improve cloud adoption among businesses and make it easier for workers to manage their day-to-day tasks. The companies promised that customers will be able to start using SAP HANA on Azure by the third quarter of 2016.
Well, Walmart is tired of only chip and sign. Now it's suing Visa for chip and PIN. So let's get this straight. The major credit card players do allow for PIN codes with their new chip credit cards, but the Walmart's rub is that users are allowed to override the PIN authorization for debit card use and go signature. The key to this New York case is that Walmart wants the credit card giants to allow them to require only a PIN and to join the Europeans and, oh, by the way, the rest of the world in using chip and PIN to hopefully reduce their financial exposure to fraud. Reading between the lines, it also seems that opting to go signature means Walmart also has to pay an additional 10 cents per transaction to go signature instead of PIN.
The Electronic Frontier Foundation, or EFS, has asked the U.S. Army Court of Criminal Appeals this past Wednesday to overturn Chelsea Manning's conviction for violating the Computer Fraud and Abuse Act, or CFFAA. Chelsea Manning is serving 35-year sentence in her role of releasing over approximately 700,000 military and diplomatic records to WikiLeaks. She was convicted of 19 counts, including one under the CFAA, which states she has unauthorized software to access State Department database. The law and rule is focused and at criminals breaking into a computer they don't have access to and not one that actually an employee has access to. The EFF believes it is turning an employee's access to a computer into a federal crime. The EFF is looking for the Army to overturn the ruling and urging Congress to make CFAA changes. Well, folks, that does it for the blips. Next up, we'll have the bites, where we'll talk about a country servicing out their citizenship and how public data could potentially force policy change. But first, we have an amazing supporter of TWIA and This Week in Enterprise Tech, and Padre wants to tell you about it. Padre?
Hey, thanks, Lou, and thanks to you and Brian and Curtis for taking care of Twyatt while I'm at Maker Faire with Brian Burnett. Did you see my sweater? Yeah, were you admiring it? Well, I have to say, I've not got the easiest body to shop for. Not a lot looks good on me, so when I found this sweater that is incredibly stylish and very technologically advanced, Well, I just had to have it, which is why we are so happy to have Ministry of Supply as a supporter of the Twiat Riot. Now, Ministry of Supply understands that your clothes need to look good on you, an actual person who actually works in the actual world, not static on a mannequin. And Ministry of Supply gives you everyday clothing. Now, that's the vision that drives the Ministry of Supply, a performance professional menswear company that launched out of MIT 4 years ago. They make polished business clothes that are engineered by MIT-trained engineers to provide technical benefits like body temperature regulation to keep you from getting too hot or too cold, sweat-wicking fibers to keep you dry, and they stretch so that you can move freely without binding. For example, this is the Aviator 2 suit. This is the suit in which the Ministry of Supply co-founder Gihan broke Guinness's world record for fastest half marathon in a suit. Now, how was that possible? Well, he was wearing that Aviator 2. It's designed around the human body in motion, not a static form used in traditional suiting. And instead of woven fabric, Aviator 2 boasts warp knit material that's exceptionally lightweight and flexible. Now, the stretchy material retains structure and shape while enabling extreme movement like that in a half marathon and flexibility. Or how about this? This is the Gemini dress shirt. It's blended cotton with temperature-regulating phase-change material, PCM. It's a NASA invention that stores and releases body heat based on surrounding climate. That means smart fabric. I told you these folks were from MIT. It's got laser-cut ventilation at the underarms to keep air flowing, and the result is a dress shirt that looks and feels totally classic while keeping you at a steady, comfortable temperature all day long. Now, all of their clothes are easy to maintain and wrinkle-resistant, and you can wash and dry them at home, so there's no need to iron. Folks, you use technology in your lives. Why not in your clothes? Shop Ministry of Supply online at ministryofsupply.com/enterprise. That's ministryofsupply.com/enterprise. And use the code ENTERPRISE for 15% off your first purchase. Or shop in person at one of their stores in Boston, San Francisco, and coming soon, Washington, D.C. Mention this show to get 15% off your first purchase in the store. How about that? Ministry of Supply. This is menswear made smarter. And we thank the Ministry of Supply for their support of This Week in Enterprise Tech. Back to you, Lou.
Thanks, Padre. So let's go ahead and jump into the bites. So this one is taking services to a new level or a new location for that matter. If you have infrastructure as a service, you have platform as a service, you have database as a service, but now you have a country as a service. The country of Estonia has one of the most developed digital signatures and infrastructures in the world, where digital signature is more used than a physical one. Almost 100% of its citizens are using EIDs or electronic IDs since 2002. Taxes take only minutes to do, and they have been doing online elections for almost a decade. The percentage of individuals using the internet to interact with public authorities was also at a high at 81%. Estonia now wants to try to take another leap forward and offer the country as a service, which basically allows individuals to become remote citizens. Governments need population and residents to back any programs or make better votes in the EU. People have been offering up their services and skills as freelancers in the online global marketplace for years, like Fiverr, Demango, etc., where their residents could be really anywhere. And really, how is this different, really? I think they live anywhere, they provide value to others, and they still pay taxes in the state that they actually reside in. Estonia is targeting these individuals by offering location independence, hassle-free, and fully digital economic and financial environment for anyone who really needs it. So let's talk about their comments. Based on their comments, they're looking to not deprive any other country or state of taxes, since a person or company will be using the resources of their state they reside in rather than actual Estonia. And they're looking to get more people and companies to engage in Estonian business environment as e-residents. With establishing e-residents, businesses will be able to start to need the services of Estonia itself, such as their banks for accounts, international payment processes, accounting, support, legal advice, etc. So really, what does Brian, I want to throw it over to you. What does dual citizen really mean for corporations and individuals corporation affairs?
Actually, I think we need to back up just a little bit and say, what does dual citizenship normally entail? Now, I know a few people that have dual citizenships. They actually have two passports because they were residents of another country but were born in the United States. And if you're born in the United States, you automatically become a U.S. citizen. Now, The weird thing is some people end up having to pay taxes in both countries. And I think it's more a matter of where your money ends up. You know, that whole thing, follow the money. Well, I think Estonia is trying to out Switzerland. And if their companies are based in Estonia, the money goes to Estonia and sits in their bank accounts, which is probably one of the key issues that Estonia is trying to do. Because if Estonian banks have the money, that means Estonian banks can make loans on that money and so forth and so on, how a bank normally makes money. Now, the interesting thing is, when will U.S. citizens or U.S. corporations pay taxes in the United States on that money? Now, normally it would be when the money comes into the U.S. Question. Well, you don't pay taxes on your Swiss bank account until the money comes into the U.S. So that starts, that means the State Department's probably going to issue some sort of statement very soon. And I bet you a lot of it's going to be around where the taxes are paid and so forth, especially if the corporate headquarters are technically still in the U.S. Now, with citizenship as a service, maybe that means the corporate headquarters are in Estonia. And that brings up the question again, where are the taxes paid? I don't think this is as cut and dry as Estonia would like it to be. I think they're going to be taking a lot of pages out of the manual from Switzerland and various other tax havens, but only time will tell. And I think the U.S. State Department's probably going to have the next word.
So I think it's interesting. I think they, the country itself does already has an extradition treaty with the United States. So people are not going to physically be fleeing there. So they're essentially going to be just remotely placing themselves as citizens so that they could. I mean, I guess the question is, what are they thinking? Why are they thinking people want to become remote citizens? I think maybe we have to talk about maybe the motivation behind that. You know, Curtis, what do you think? What do you think might be the motivation behind somebody wanting to be a remote citizen rather than potentially, let's say, a citizen or even a corporation of the United States?
Well, I would say that there's a big difference between what corporations can do as entities within other jurisdictions and what U.S. citizens can do. For example, the United States is pretty much unique in the world in that we tax the income our citizens receive anywhere in the world. It doesn't matter if someone has not been a resident in the U.S. for years. If they are entirely resident overseas, they still owe U.S. federal taxes. So from that perspective, it is going to be difficult to say that U.S. citizens should go and become remote citizens of Estonia unless they're ready at some point to forego their American citizenship. Now, corporations are a different thing entirely. We've seen a lot of cases recently where a larger U.S. corporation will buy a smaller corporation located somewhere else, typically in Europe, and then basically switch the entire legal headquarters of the corporation to that international firm for tax purposes. It's called a tax inversion. It's been really popular in sectors like pharmaceuticals. And our Congress has been working really, really hard to try and make it so that this is no longer an attractive option. It's actually one of the very few things our divided Congress can agree upon that we really, really, really want to get our hands on their money. For remote citizens elsewhere, I will say that when you are working in a country outside of your country of residence, there are all kinds of services that are available to a citizen through the various embassies around the world and consulates. There are advantages that accrue to you. And so I can see where in a lot of cases, this would be really popular, really useful, and quite practical. I just think that for most purposes, it is less so for a U.S. citizen than it is for citizens of most countries around the world.
Makes sense. So I think one thing, I mean, I don't pretend to be a lawyer, nor do am I a lawyer, but I wanted to, you know, this sounds some strange. So if somebody were to create a corporation, let's say in Estonia, and then of course, normally corporations, they assign in, let's say an IP agreement. And that means that all the IP of that corporation now belongs to that corporation. You know, what do you think the ramifications are around that, around ownership of IP and a kind of cross border ownership, and of course, even bandwidth and all that type of stuff?
You know, it starts coming down to where was it created? And if you're a digital citizen, try saying that three times fast. Where is your intellectual property parked? I think that's going to be a really big issue. And I think this is, again, a very sly plan by Estonia, that they're going to probably employ a heck of a lot of Estonian lawyers to try and protect the IP. And I predict there's going to be a decent number of people that are going to park IP in Estonia. I don't think we've heard the last of this. I think sooner or later, the State Department and obviously the Department of Taxation and a few other folks, and obviously our friends in the U.S. Congress, are probably going to chime in on this. And this is going to be a really, really interesting landmark case, probably on the same kind of category as what happened with Kim.com. You know, that was a landmark case, and I think this one's going to be another one.
Absolutely, yeah. I think it's going to be interesting to see how this kind of plays out. So now we have another bite. This is an interesting one too as well. The story surfaced this, the concept of the possibility that we, you know, putting data in the hands of citizens will potentially make a city run better and even make it more equitable. The story goes into the very simple concept of parking tickets and how a change in a policy in 2009 has caused a bunch of citizens from being charged for tickets even though they were parking legally. In 2009, New York City made a change to its parking rules, stating that you can park in front of a sidewalk pedestrian ramp as long as it's not connected to a crosswalk. This individual who wrote the article talks about how they took the initiative and went through all the New York City's open data portal to see where the most common parking spots in the city people were actually parking and where they were ticketed. This is interesting because most cities and state governors don't actually post this type of data, this type of public data anywhere. And by posting this data, they were able to go through using Google Maps to determine all the different zones in the city where the legal parking spots were, according to the new policy change, and where the city was still charging people for violations. So they were able to kind of cross-reference the public data around people were getting tickets versus what they saw were actually, you know, legal zones. So they were actually able to find hundreds of thousands of dollars in missed ticketed instances. Not only did the NYPD admit to the mistake, they responded with the reason. The officers said basically that they were not parking meter attendants and they were not educated on the policy and were actually writing tickets in error, and they would take the steps to actually correct and educate their officers. So so this is very interesting because this kind of opens the door to you know, potential lawsuits, and you know, it also kind of opens the door to whether the concept that we think that you know, the NYPD might actually get sued for unwanted parking tickets, even though the policy changed. So I want to throw it over to you, Brian. What do you think? I mean, do you think that this has opened the door for the NYPD to stop posting, and even New York City to stop posting this data because they're opening the door to potential lawsuits?
I don't think it's just New York City. There is policies that I heard at the Western Governors Association conference about a move for additional transparency in almost all municipalities across the United States. The citizens of the United States have demanded more transparency, and an open government movement has certainly got some legs here in Honolulu, and more databases from civil service, you know, government services are being opened up for examination. Now, one of the issues that is slowing it down are issues on privacy to make sure that you're not, you know, opening it up. You know, one of the big ones were sexual offenders. You know, how do you open the database for examination but without violating the privacy laws? So something like that's going to be interesting. I see it as something that's going to happen more and more across the United States. And I think more and more municipalities are going to need to open their databases because the voting public is demanding it.
Yeah, I think that's interesting. I think so. In some cities like Seattle, they have this concept of the HOV lane, which is called high occupancy lanes, and where citizens can go to a site and actually report violators. So when they see, it's kind of like a crowdsourcing type thing. I want to, Curtis, I want to throw it over to you. What do you think? Do you think that, you know, is it really the cities that need to be, or the governments that need to be posting this data? Or do you think that the more value is in potentially crowdsourcing the data and making decisions off of that?
Well, I think that governments have the advantage of already having the data in many cases. And in a lot of those cases, they are nice repositories for data. It's interesting because I've seen over the past 3 or 4 years, a number of cases of municipalities doing things like this. Boston was a famous proponent of this and an early adopter. Philadelphia has done a great deal on this with things like getting citizens to report where potholes exist. That's one of those quality of life things that is seen as an indicator for other problems that can crop up. Boston started doing that first, where residents could report potholes, put them on the map, and then track them as they were repaired. In smaller cities, Asheville, North Carolina is doing a great deal. So we're seeing this already in action, and it's working as a nice partnership where basically the city puts up its store of a basic information and asks the citizens to enrich that database. It's something that can work really well as long as both sides know what's expected and what the reasonable outcomes can be.
Right. I think that's interesting because I think a lot of companies, like, for instance, we've seen a lot of data breaches lately where, you know, data's been posted publicly and people are making decisions whether they trust organizations or not. And this is kind of the flip side of things, saying government's going to start posting potentially non-identifiable data to you where you can potentially make your own decisions and maybe even help them with the policy changes. So it's kind of an interesting balancing act, it almost seems like. I mean, it's almost like they're what they're calling open sourcing data, where you have, it's basically a better way to get issues at bay. So what do you think, Brian? Do you think it's something that, you know, it's going to take on, governments are going to take it on more, maybe even corporations will take it on more to make more sense out of the people and maybe have the people help them?
Well, I think there's been a few attempts already. There was a system called Bump that apparently closed their doors not terribly long ago. And it was an opt-in system where, you know, you could text to Bump the license plate of a car and what was wrong, you know, brake light out, drunk drive, you know, whatever. And apparently nobody wanted to opt in. Now, in the case of what is the citizenship doing, I've heard several municipalities that are now listening to Waze. You know, Waze has an ability to put up, you know, road hazards, potholes, you name, even roadkill. And tell you, listening to Morgan Freeman tell you that there's roadkill in front of you is hilarious because Waze had Morgan Freeman for a while. I think this is going to be more and more. Municipalities are not going to be able to afford to do a lot of things that they would want to do. And I think the private industry is starting to step up. Now, the big question is, will it go too far? And I think that's one of the things that Jabba was trying to point out in the chat room when he actually brought up the white pages list for Brian Chee in Hawaii. And there's actually quite a bit of information on me, and that's no big surprise because I've got a pretty open profile. But I'll tell you, just having that type of information publicly available does kind of set an interesting tone for where the world is going in general. And 1984, George Orwell, here we are.
Absolutely. Well, gentlemen, let's move on. We do have a pretty great guest, and we'll give it a chance to jump in into some big data and the land called Hadoop. We have TJ Lair from Cloudera. But before we do that, let's go ahead and thank another sponsor for this episode of This Week Enterprise Tech. And Padre wants to tell you about it. Padre.
Thanks, Lou. Thanks for letting us take this little break to talk about the next sponsor of This Week in Enterprise Tech. Now, let me ask you something. What's the worst thing that could happen to your company? A lot of people think that a data breach is the worst thing. I mean, that's the exposing of sensitive information, maybe even customer data that gets you into a lot of trouble with the FTC. Well, I hate to tell you this, but that's not the worst thing that can happen to your company. The worst thing isn't a breach. The worst thing is a breach that you don't know is happening, which is why we are so happy to have Things Canary as a sponsor of the Twiat Riot. Now, the Things Canary is a different way of looking at security. A canary is a honeypot. It's a way to trick attackers into revealing their techniques, their vectors of exploitation, and what they're actually looking for on your network. You sprinkle a few of them in your network, make one look like a router. Another one looks like an unprotected Windows file share. A third is an IoT device. And you can even enroll them in Active Directory so that your attacker doesn't think that they're vulnerable. They think that they're valuable. You can set them up in as little as 4 minutes, and then you can just sit back and wait for your canaries to start singing. Speaking of singing, you'll get a single alert when your canaries identify a verified attack activity. This is important because alert fatigue from hundreds or even thousands of false positives are a great way to miss the real attacks. Thinx, that's the company behind Canary, has been in the security game for almost 2 decades. They've trained countless companies, militaries, and governments on how to break into networks. That means that they also know how to protect them. And Thinx use that experience to build the Canary. You're probably thinking that security like this is going to cost way too much. But the beauty of the Canary system is that you can start with a few, then scale up as your network and your needs grow. Things Canaries are deployed around the world, from Iceland to Australia, with some of the biggest names in the Silicon Valley using them to identify threats before they become company-ending breaches. If they trust their Canaries, I'm thinking that you'll love yours. Check out canary.tools/twit to get more information or to see them in action. For just $7,500 per year, you get 5 Canaries, your own hosted console, upgrades, support, and maintenance for a full year. And just for the audience of This Week in Enterprise Tech, if you visit canary.tools/twit and enter the code TWIT in the How Did You Hear About Us box, you'll get 10% off your canaries for life. We're sure that you'll love your Things Canaries, but if you're not happy, you can always return your canaries within their 2-month money-back guarantee for a full refund. Visit canary.tools/twit, canary.tools/twit, and enter the code TWIT in the How Did You Hear About Us box to receive your 10% off your canaries for life. And we thank Thinkst and their canaries for supporting This Week in Enterprise Tech. Back to my friends on This Week in Enterprise Tech.
Thanks, Padre. So let's go into my favorite part of the show where we get to bring in an expert and they get to share their knowledge with the Twiat Riot. We welcome TJ Lair, the product marketing manager at Cloudera. How are you doing, TJ?
I'm doing great. Thanks for having me.
Thanks for coming. So for the folks playing at home, we always have the kind of the first day sort of thing where since it's your first time on the show, can you tell us a little bit about yourself and about what Cloudera does?
Absolutely. That's a great question. So I'll start with myself. My name is TJ Lair, born and raised in the Bay Area, went to school out here and then immediately made my way into tech. What I do on the weekends besides working for Cloudera is fly fishing. That's my passion. Love going up to the great state of Montana and doing some fly fishing up there. So more about Cloudera, the company and the technology of Apache Hadoop. Cloudera is a commercial distribution of Apache Hadoop. So we are the first commercial distribution to hit the market back in 2008. And we are, in essence, building the next generation data management and analytics platform to help organizations leverage the open source components that are Apache Hadoop to solve some of the most pressing business problems that they have. These problems span 4 key areas that we usually see. 3 of those areas relate to line of businesses. So we are helping our customers better understand their customers. We are helping them lower their business risk by deploying solutions such as cybersecurity, fraud detection, and compliance. And we are also helping them take advantage of the IoT world that they're operating in today to help improve products and services that they are giving to their clientele. And so what we do is we come in, deploy our platform with the help of our partner ecosystem, help them achieve their business objectives, and we layer on additional proprietary tooling to help them with the security, the management, and the governance of this platform to make sure it adheres to the strictest compliance regulations and enterprise regulations. It speaks directly to the points that you guys were just discussing around data protection, cybersecurity, and all of those great features.
Gotcha. So since you mentioned Hadoop, I know you're saying Cloudera is one of the first distros of Hadoop. Can you give us just a quick high-level idea of what Hadoop is and what the motivation was around developing it and how it can really help an enterprise or a small business or even an enterprise business?
That's a great question. Absolutely. So Hadoop in a lot of people's minds and the core Hadoop projects are HDFS and MapReduce. Hadoop's distributed file system is what HDFS stands for, so it's a storage system. And MapReduce, which is a batch processing engine. That is core Hadoop, and that's what a lot of people think about when they mention Hadoop. Hadoop has now been around for 10 years, so it's significantly extended beyond that core Hadoop to offer additional components that work with the core Hadoop as well as other big data open source technologies to help organizations leverage their data in new and emerging ways, such as applying machine learning via the Spark engine, right, to do anomaly detection or build net new models, to do SQL queries against the data that's located in Hadoop via Impala, which is another component. So Hadoop, the word Hadoop has quickly extended beyond that core Hadoop components such as HDFS and MapReduce to include hundreds of different components that operate within the big data ecosystem. And all these open source projects are managed by the Apache Software Foundation. So they are the ones that actually are the governing bodies to make sure that all these projects have good community involvement. And what we do is we look at the Apache Software Foundation and we pull in a variety of these big data components into our platform. So we have 20 plus components that make up our next generation analytics platform. And we make sure that we're listening to our customers as they're trying to leverage big data in new and emerging ways. And that demand from our customers is helping us determine whether or not the components that we currently have in our stack will help meet those needs, or whether we have to go back to the open source community to see if there's a cutting edge project coming out of the likes of Berkeley, such as Spark, that we need to embed into our platform to help meet their business objectives. So moving on to the second part of your question around what our customers are doing with our platform, there's a main kind of fundamental shift in the way IT organizations and departments are operating. They're trying to figure out ways to take advantage of big data, right? And when we say big data, a lot of people think of the three Vs that the Gartner analysts created: volume, velocity, and variety. Hadoop is a great system to handle that. It can scale to whatever volumes you need because of the linear scalability of Hadoop and the ability to add additional commodity hardware to extend the processing or the storage capabilities of your Hadoop platform. So that's one major area where people just want to store and process larger volumes of information. But another major area that's emerging is analytics. So actually doing your data science on a Hadoop platform because it offers a wide variety of benefits, such as housing historic complete data sets, full fidelity data sets. So data that hasn't yet been transformed, it's the raw data. You don't have to go back to that source system. You can immediately access that data out of one system. And then also putting these models into production environments, right? So once you build a recommendation model, it's a very clumsy experience in today's world of actually taking that model and putting it into production, and it involves a lot of additional purchases and systems. But with the Hadoop platform and with all these 20 plus components, you can leverage the same platform you just did your model development on to actually put that model into production. So eHarmony is one of our customers. So every time you see that eHarmony recommendation of someone that you should speak to, that is being served via a Cloudera Hadoop platform.
Great. So I think, Brian, you had a question about potentially how Hadoop can play a role in the enterprise, right?
Well, I take the academia view, And one of the big questions is academia is really interested in big data, but there's an awful lot of FUD being spread around about how expensive and how complex Hadoop instance is. So I've actually got a question about that. You know, what it, does it take to get started for TJ? And then I'd like to go and put Lou back on the hot seat and see from an Azure standpoint, what does it take to get started? So why don't we start with TJ?
That's a great question. Yeah, so Hadoop's been around for 10 years, like I just mentioned. And with that maturity in Hadoop, we've built tooling to make it easier for you to deploy and manage your Hadoop distribution to get up and going easy. And when I say deploy and manage, what I'm speaking to is one of our tools, Cloudera Manager. So, you know, you brought up an interesting point, Brian, about academics and leveraging big data technologies to help further a variety of fields in academia. And one of our founders, Jeff Hammerbacher, who was one of the early data scientists over at Facebook, he's actually an end user of our platform. And he did that strategically to help offer us direct feedback around how easy it is to manage our platform and things that need to be fixed and improved. So he's working with Mount Sinai right now to do some in-depth research around personalized medicine. So we see people like that breaking down the barriers of what was possible in academics by using our technology and using core components of our unique product suite like CM, Cloudera Manager, to help make it easier for you to get started on this platform.
Cool. Lou, I'm going to turn the tables and ask you. From a Microsoft standpoint, I know Microsoft Azure supports Hadoop, but how do I get started?
It's a good question, Brian. So I think, you know, Microsoft has two ways to implement Hadoop. You have the platform as a service way of doing it, and of course the IaaS way. So you could potentially spin up a bunch of VMs, and then you could place Cloudera or whatever distribution of Hadoop you want on the cluster, and then, you know, have it run against your data store. But, you know, there are some pretty essential, easy ways to kind of get yourself started. One way would be, you know, I'll give you the example of, you know, a company that might have a ton of IoT devices and they're pumping data up to potentially some data source. You could potentially use IoT Hub or what they something called Event Hub and Azure, where essentially it's an engine that will take all of the millions and billions of events that happen from IoT devices and it will store them locally to allow you to query them against it. And then you could use something like ASA, which is the Azure Analytics engine, would basically allow you to write queries against the IoT Hub and, you know, ingress data and actually egress data. So you'd be able to do a little bit of data calculation and so on. And then you could put it between both what they call a hot path and a cold path, because a lot of analytics could happen potentially in real time where people want to see stream analytics and they want to be able to know what's going on in real time. Potentially a customer wants to see things changing and they want to visualize that. And of course the cold path. And so you could put a cold path where that data gets sent into some other data source like maybe Azure Blob Storage or Data Warehouse, where then you can then, if you want to run some analytics on it, depending on whether it's structured or unstructured data, you have the option to spin up a cluster of Hadoop, run it against the data source, run some analytics, and then take down that cluster of Hadoop once you're done. And then from there, you could essentially spin up some kind of a visualization, whether it's a web role or whatnot, to basically visualize what was analyzed and what the output of that analytics was. So there's lots of different ways to do it, and it all depends on your scenario. But again, companies like Cloudera and Microsoft and Google, they're making it a lot easier for companies to start up and move forward. So I think, Brian, I think you're on mute.
Well, this is Curt. I'm not on mute, and I wanted to leap in with a question coming at it from a slightly different angle, because I saw Cloudera at Sapphire this week, and the SAP folks make a great deal about all of the customers that are using Hadoop to come back and supply the data that's being transferred over to something like HANA for analysis, and especially in the industrial Internet of Things. So, Anthony, I know you were talking about doing analysis within Hadoop, But how important is it to be able to connect Hadoop to other databases for analysis, especially when you're using Hadoop as the first order data lake for dumping massive loads of things like industrial IoT data into?
Yeah, it's a great question. So SAP HANA, Teradata, Oracle, we have 2,300 partners in our ecosystem. We realize that a lot of organizations already have made significant investments in their data management and analytics space to make sure that they supplied the tools they needed to their end users. So a lot of times we're doing exactly what you just described, where we're coming in and we're sitting alongside these tools like SAP HANA to be that big data storage system. And as more and more use cases come to that system, you know, maybe SAP HANA is not the right system to build your recommendation engine in. For example, we see people developing those types of systems on our platform. So 100%, we sit alongside all of those existing data management systems. And to Lou's point around having a cold data system and a hot data system, depending on what that data source is and what end users actually need to see that data source, that is a great way to think about the problem at hand and what data should land in what system. So depending on how frequently that data needs to be accessed, depending on what type of analytics you need to do on that data, it might be better suited for SAP HANA versus Hadoop. But the great part about Hadoop is the lower cost per storage, because you can deploy the Hadoop software on commodity hardware or in a cloud environment. So it's a great complement to SAP HANA to kind of manage that overall data management TCO.
So, Anthony, real quick, one thing that I know, you talked a little bit about security before, and a lot of people, you know, when they have data, they might have lots and lots of data, whether it be customer data or it be just unstructured data that's coming from different sources. And a lot of times they have requirements around data being at rest and sometimes being, you know, secured and encrypted and so on. How does Cloudera handle that sort of thing when it comes to, you know, securing one's data when they're kind of sending it across the cluster and running analytics on it?
Yeah, it's a great question. So security is a top of mind priority for us and for our customers. So we've made a few major strides in security through some key acquisitions and partnerships. So one I'd like to mention is Gazang. So a couple years back in 2014, we acquired a company called Gazang that gave us encryption and key management capabilities for all the data that touches the cluster, that's inside the cluster, and all that additional metadata, to make sure that any data that's located within the enterprise data hub is 100% encrypted. But we saw that with any sort of encryption, there's obviously a performance tax on decrypting that data in order for it to be usable for the user. So that's where our strategic partnership with Intel. So Intel put $720 million into our company because they saw us as being the leaders within the space. And they wanted to help us improve our overall platform. And one of those ways we've helped improve our platform is through moving the encryption down to the chip level. And what this allows our customers to do is make sure that as they encrypt more and more data, pretty much all their data that's located in our platform, they don't see that performance gain because a lot of that encryption is pushed down to the Intel chipset. And if they do see a performance tax, they can add an additional machine to scale that out to make sure that the quality of service of the data management analytics platform and of Cloudera remains performant.
Thanks, TJ. I want to apologize too. I had Anthony or TD on our brain when I mentioned your name, so I apologize for that. So when we come back, we want to talk a little bit more about Hadoop and how it's helping enterprises, and talk about how it's basically forcing some change in the ecosystem. But first, we have another great sponsor for this week in Enterprise Tech episode, and Padre wants to tell you about it. Padre.
Thanks again, Lou. Let's go ahead and take a moment to thank another sponsor of This Week in Enterprise Tech. And first of all, I want to ask you IT engineers a few things. Are you happy with your network? Those 10 base T repeaters, are they working out? How about your ISDN lines? Are they behaving? Oh, those 486 desktops, are they still pumping out in the background? Of course not, because that technology went out in the 90s. So then why are you still using an intranet from that time? Well, of course, it was nice back in the day. You had all the information that you needed to do your business decisions at your fingertips, and it gave you some of the best things of the internet combined with business-specific information. But today, that system just looks old and tired. And that's why we're so happy to have Igloo as a supporter of the Twiet Riot. Now, Igloo is an internet that you'll actually like. It's a cloud platform that enables you to share files, collaborate on documents, blog updates, coordinate calendars, and manage projects all from the same attractive and intuitive interface. Of course, access to all that information needs to be protected. So Igloo baked SSL and 256-bit encryption services into the platform. This lets you grant access to drag-and-drop widgets, a WYSIWYG editor, and permission-based content just to the users who need it. Unlike a lot of the other solutions out there, Igloo lets you customize your platform and integrate your existing IT investments. This ain't no forklift upgrade where you're going to have to throw away everything that came before it. You can use Office 365, Salesforce, SharePoint, Active Directory, and file sharing solutions like Google Drive and Dropbox, all from within your Igloo with your branding, your look, and your feel. You can even add Zendesk to keep track of and to add new support tickets. Most importantly, with your branding, your look and feel, your users will always feel as if they are inside your internet, not jumping off to different solutions from different vendors. They can work anywhere they want, on the desktop, on mobile, on tablet, and it will always look like it's your company. It's used by large enterprises and growing companies like User Testing, BDO, American Family Insurance, and ATP World Tour. They get it. You should too. Here's what we want you to do. We want you to sign up now and try it for free at igloosoftware.com/twit. That's igloosoftware.com/twit. And when you sign up through our link, you can get your own Igloo for up to 10 people absolutely free for as long as you want. Again, that's igloosoftware.com/twit. And we thank Igloo Software for their support of this week in Enterprise Tech. One last time, back over to the Twiet folk. Lou, take it away.
Actually, I'm going to toss the next question. And from a, again, academic standpoint, if I have a system that's currently on a SQL database of some sort, TJ, what kind of things do I need to look at? What kinds of things do I need to put into my planning path to migrate to a big data system?
That's a great question. So there's a variety of different things that you should look at depending on what you're trying to actually achieve with the big data system. Are you trying to just have that system for long-term data storage and processing? Are you looking to have that system to execute analytics on? Or are you trying to have that system to build net new applications for your clientele? So depending on what you're trying to actually accomplish, the package or the different components of our distribution will be needed, right? So you might need a real-time ingestion and processing pipeline that might be facilitated with something like Kafka and Spark, right? Versus if you're trying to execute machine learning algorithms or try to stand up a BI environment where you're just executing Impala for SQL queries, you will need Impala as an example, right? So from a perspective of what components you need, you should definitely first and foremost think about what you're trying to achieve with this big data platform and what the end user application would be from this platform: data processing, analytics, or net new data application. That will tell you what components of the Hadoop distribution you need to deploy. After that, it's all about the hardware or the cloud environment that you want to stand it up in. So crawl, walk, run, figure out if you want to make a massive investment with multiple racks stood up, or if you want to just run some ad hoc workloads in Microsoft Azure as an example. Figure out what that plan looks like to slowly migrate more and more data over to the Hadoop distribution. Figure out what the best deployment model looks like, either on-prem or in the cloud. And then, you know, always keep in mind what that end user is actually going to be doing with that platform: data processing, analytics, or building a net new application.
TJ, I wanted to ask you, you mentioned the idea of data migration in your last answer. And data migration can be an enormously time-intensive, effort-intensive, and complicated process. So what kind of tools are you seeing out there to help with data migration? Is it at a point where there are more automated options rather than just the sort of bare bones, less automated options that were available a few years ago? Or is it still one of those things where you have to grit your teeth and bear the pain in order to reap the rewards that come down the line?
Yeah, it's a great question. So there are components in the Hadoop ecosystem that helps with data migration, Scoop, Flume, right, depending on what you're actually trying to ingest and move into the data platform. We also have a variety of different ETL vendors in the space that help bridge the gap from your existing, you know, SQL database into your Hadoop distribution, as an example. So there has been some serious progress made with making it easier for you to migrate that existing data sources that you've already collected into your Hadoop distribution. But the great part about Hadoop is you can land more data in there that you would have not thought possible with your traditional relational database. So social data, weather data is just two examples, because no schema is required within a Hadoop platform. And because of the fact that you can store data at a lower cost per terabyte, we see a lot of people migrating and moving just data they think could potentially be valuable at a later date into the system, right? And because there's no schema required, they can land it there without having to put a lot of thought and process into the schema. And then as that data is slowly being used, they create the schema, and then they create the analytics on top of that information when it's applicable and when it makes sense for their business. So our partner ecosystem paired with open source components that make it easier to migrate, and then just the fundamentals of Hadoop with it being schema on write versus schema on read, or schema on read versus schema on write, makes it easier for organizations to migrate data into our platform.
Very good. Well, I wanted to ask a question. It's interesting because a lot of our viewers may or may not know that we've got sort of a back channel going amongst the host where we decide on who's going to ask which questions. And Lou and I had similar questions to ask you, and that's about hybrid. And the question, you mentioned hybrid, and I know that most people think of hybrid as being a on-prem portion versus a cloud-based portion, and I know that that is one flavor, but are you seeing a lot of people who want to do two separate cloud instances on two different cloud systems, say one that is a more of a private cloud and something out on the public cloud? How are you seeing those hybrid instances work, and is there a big difference in the consideration that companies have of how to make them work if they're cloud to cloud versus cloud to and on-prem?
Yeah, so I'd like to talk about one of our products that we've invested significant time and money into because of this demand coming from our customer base, and it's called Cloudera Director, and it offers the flexibility that you just described, being able to manage multiple clusters, Hadoop clusters, between on-prem and cloud environments. And that cloud environment can either be in the public cloud or it can be in the private cloud, depending on the current posture of that organization. So there's too many flavors of it, to be honest. You know, some people are very strict and old school and saying we're 100% on-prem, which is where Hadoop was born and raised, so it naturally fits that that scope. But there's some new organizations who are born and raised in the cloud world, and that's where all their data resides, and they want to be able to leverage the components of Hadoop in this cloud environment. And there's about three different ways, I should say, this to kind of set the stage that we see organizations leveraging cloud. One is setting up transient clusters in the cloud for high peak work hours. So imagine I only have hardware to support my standard running business, but I know my data science team is going to spin up a bunch of workloads where I need additional resources. So for that 1 month or 1 week project, I extend the capability and capacity of my cluster by standing up a quick workload within or for that particular project. That's one example that we see. We see the people that are going 100% native cloud, which is an emerging trend, especially as people become more and more comfortable with storing all of their data in the cloud, including customer data and credit card information and all that extremely PII and PCI compliant information. So that's another one that we see. And then the third one is a little interesting. Because with the cloud world, we can decouple compute from storage, allowing us to scale those independently. So we can create an environment where we perhaps scale compute at a different level than we scale storage, and we can use that cloud environment to scale that compute level versus, you know, keeping our storage level at the same level. So this is very difficult, and I just want to lay out all those possibilities because we see a different environment in every one of our customers. So making it easier for you to manage that cross hybrid environment on-prem and in the cloud environment, and then managing all those different cloud deployment options that you have, it quickly becomes extremely complex. And having those options is why we're here and why we're holding our customers' hands as they make their way into the cloud and start to leverage the cloud to their advantage more and more frequently.
So TJ, you kind of mentioned this before, and I know that we're running out of time, but it's kind of a big subject, but I wanted to kind of squeak these in there just a bit. And there was a subject around Spark. And of course, there's other things like Hadoop. Hadoop Yarn, and there's Mesos. Can you maybe go through some of these other toolings and these other products that kind of work along with and or on top of Hadoop to make it a little bit more useful and or fit particular needs?
Absolutely. So there's a lot of different projects from storage engines to processing engines to analytic engines. So when you think about Hadoop, you should be thinking about how all these different systems come together and work together. So from a storage system, we got HDFS, we got HBase, and then we got a new storage system that just was released into beta a little while ago called Kudu, which allows you to do fast analytics on fast moving data. So think IoT storage for that particular example. As you store the data within your Hadoop distribution, you can access the data in a variety of different ways. Comparing that to the old world where you just have a SQL database and a search database, Hadoop offers all those different access frameworks on the same data. So you can have interactive SQL queries with tools such as Impala, which is an open source tool that was created at Cloudera. You can do simple search queries against the data that's located in your Hadoop distribution through Cloudera Search. You can run machine learning algorithms using Spark. And Spark has a great machine learning library, which is MLlib, where you can take certain algorithms and execute it using Spark to analyze data and create net new models. And then there's the simple batch processing engines that have existed for multiple years, such as MapReduce, for those large, heavy lifting jobs that you need to do. But we see a transition and a changing of the guards when it comes to data processing, with Spark seeing great traction and great adoption within our partner ecosystem and with our customer base because of the flexibility Spark offers with being able to execute machine learning algorithms, be able to do batch processing as well as stream processing on data. And as people want to move closer and closer to real time, we see great promise in that project. And we're betting significantly on Spark with projects such as the One Platform Initiative, which outlines our product roadmap for Spark.
Very cool. Well, we've done it again. We've run out of time. You've used up another hour of the best dang enterprise podcast in the universe, according to 9 out of 10 unstructured pieces of data. TJ Lair, Product Marketing Manager from Cloudera, thank you so much for being on This Week in Enterprise Tech. Your knowledge has been very helpful for even me. And we'd love to have you back because we've only kind of scratched the surface, I think, of big data and even uses for Hadoop. So, if you would like, we'd love to have you back soon.
I'd love to be back. I was enjoying listening to your guys' was it blips and all that great stuff at the beginning. So you got a fan and a longtime listener right now, and I'd love to be back on the show.
Thanks, TJ. So real quick, I also want to thank my co-hosts. It wouldn't be Twit without you, my colleagues, the reason for this great show, starting with you, Curtis. Always amazing working with you. I love hearing from your deep insights and scope of knowledge. Can you tell the folks where they can find you and all the work you've done at Information Radio?
Well, they can find everything that I'm doing, audio, video, and text over at informationweek.com. I'm going to have more analysis and wrap-up from Sapphire coming up shortly. That's going to fill much of the next week, along with a couple of interesting articles on things like books that every CIO should plan to read in order to make themselves a better CIO. So come on over to informationweek.com. Look me up. I promise we'll try to make it something worthwhile.
That's Mr. Curtis Franken from Information Week Radio. Always a pleasure. Mr. Brian Chee, where can we find you and what you're up to and what's next on your slate?
Well, I am ADVNETLAB on Twitter, but I've actually got a story up on the InfoWorld site. It's a slideshow, and it's 19 tools for the IT specialist. We're actually calling it MacGyver tools. Little things that you can add to your year-end budget that will certainly make your life a lot easier over time. And these happen to be tools that I use on a pretty regular basis. I've actually worn a couple of them out. I've actually had a couple of stolen from me, darn. But they're great tools, and the slideshow is currently up on the InfoWorld site.
Thanks, Brian. Mr. Brian Chee, Director of the Advanced Network Computer Laboratory in Honolulu. Amazing to have you. And thank you, TJ, again, Product Marketing Manager for Cloudera. Could you tell the folks a little bit about where you could find you and, of course, what's next for Cloudera?
So thank you for having me. You can find more information about everything I discussed on our website at cloudera.com. You can follow my Twitter handle at TJ Layer, where I'm posting all of our cutting-edge projects that we are releasing into the open source community. And, you know, watch out for Cloudera to really make a splash in the cloud and cybersecurity market. We're making some great investments and working with our partner ecosystem to help protect organizations from a cyber analytics perspective. We announced some interesting open source projects with Intel called Open Network Insight. And then, you know, cloud came up in today's conversation. It's something we're thinking about with Cloudera Director. And there should be some great news coming out with partners such as Microsoft Azure and all the other great partners in the space.
Great. Thank you so much for having you. And of course, thank you to you, our loyal listeners and viewers. We love doing this show, and we couldn't do this show without you. You come back week after week, and we want to make it really easy for you to listen and view Twiat. So head over right now to twit.tv/Twiat. Once you're there, you'll see the entire archive of all the Twiat episodes, show notes, especially this episode. Check out episode 189, the Packet Pusher in high def audio and video. You can check out episode 188, interop coverage for your mobile phone, your tablet, your desktop, every which way you need it, and enjoy the show in different formats to fit your needs. Subscribe and listen each week. Also, remember, we do the show live every Friday, 1:30 Pacific. You can check us out live at live.twit.tv to see the behind the scenes and as we build out the show. As long as you're watching live, why not jump on our live chat room as well as irc.twit.tv. You can ask questions to co-hosts. You can ask questions to guests. You can inspire us with your amazing wisdom and comments. And if you inspire us enough, we might actually take the show in a different direction. Finally, I want to thank everyone at Twit who makes this show possible. Thanks to Leo and Lisa for allowing us to continue to do This Week in Enterprise Tech week after week. Thank you to Carson, the super producer. Thank you to Father Robert Ballister for including us in his adventure and enterprise each week. And of course, thank you to the TD this week, Anthony. Anthony, you have a camera on yourself there?
Hey.
Thank you so much.
You're welcome.
Where can we find you and what you do?
You can just follow me on Twitter at @anielsen. So that's it.
Fantastic. Thanks, Anthony. You can always find me and follow me at twitter.com/luomm. And a great place to see where, you know, what I do outside of the show, and also a great place to suggest topics and guests for future episodes. So until next time, I'm Louis Maresca, just reminding you, if you want to know what's going on in the enterprise, just keep twining.